In the last video, we covered all the bones of the wrist and hand, but bones on their own would just fall apart. So how do they stay connected and move in such control when you make a fist or flex your fingers? It all comes down to this, the joints. In this video, we are going to go through every major joint in the wrist and hand. So we will cover the radiocarpal joints, intercarpal joints, and the midcarpal joints. Then we will move on to the carpometacarpal joints, intermetacarpal joints, metacarpophalangeal joints, and finally the interphalangeal joints. What's up everyone? My name is Taim, I'm a medical doctor and I make animated medical lectures to make different topics in medicine visually easier to understand. If you would like a PDF version or a quiz of this presentation, you can find it on my website, along with organized video lectures to help with your studies. Alright, let's get started. Let's set the ground properly first and build brick by brick. So, for orientation, we are looking at the front of the hand now. In the previous video on the radius and ulna, we covered the interosseous membrane and the distal radio-ulnar joints. We have followed the joint down to this point. The next joint after that is the radiocarpal joint, or simply, the wrist joint. Make sense? Let's start here. The wrist joint is where the forearm meets the hand. And it's not just a simple hinge, it's made up of several parts coming together. First, we have the carpal articular surface of the radius, and on the other side, interestingly, the ulna does not directly articulate with the carpal bones. Instead, there is something called the articular disc that lies here, in some sources referred to as the triangular fibrocartilage complex, or TFCC in short. It's a thin but strong piece of fibrocartilage. Think of it as a shock absorber that also helps distribute forces across the wrist and stabilize the ulnar side. Pretty cool. Now, distally, we've got three carpal bones forming the other half of this joint, the scaphoid, lunate, and the triquetrum. These articulate with the radius and the articular disc to complete the radiocarpal joints. And all of this is enclosed within a joint capsule. Like most synovial joints, we've got a synovial membrane lining the inside, which secretes a nice lubricating synovial fluid. And around it, a fibrous capsule that gives the joint its strength. You will see some sources refer to this fibrous capsule as a part of the general ligamentous support, and that is fair, because it does add passive stability. But in addition to the capsule, the wrist joint is reinforced by a whole set of ligaments that support it from all directions. These ligaments are typically grouped based on their position. On the palmar side, we've got the palmar radiocarpal ligament, and next to it, the palmar ulnocarpal ligament. These two help stabilize the joint from the front, connecting the radius and the ulna to the carpal bones. On the sides, there's the ulnar collateral ligament, which runs from the styloid process of the ulna to the triquetrum and pisiform. And on the other side, there is the radial collateral ligament, which goes from the styloid process of the radius to the scaphoid. And these two help prevent excessive sideways movements. Now, let's flip around and take a look at the back of the wrist. Here, you will see the dorsal radiocarpal ligament, which is basically the posterior counterpart of the palmar one, stabilizing the joint from behind. And we can also see the dorsal ulnocarpal ligament here as well. So that is the radiocarpal joint. And what makes it really useful is what it can do. It allows palmar flexion, that is bending the wrist forward, and dorsiflexion, which is just extension. Then we also have adduction or ulnar deviation, where the hand moves towards the pinky side, and abduction or radial deviation, where it moves towards the thumb. It's a biaxial ellipsoid joint, which just means that it can move in two planes. And that makes it perfect for those smooth wrist circles. Alright, let's now move a little bit down to the intercarpal joints. These are the joints between the individual carpal bones themselves, like little articulations between neighbors in the same row. And just like the wrist, they are held together by ligaments. On the palmar side, these are collectively referred to as the palmar intercarpal ligaments. And on the back, they're reinforced by the dorsal intercarpal ligaments. These ligaments don't just stabilize, they also help with force distribution across the wrist where the hand is under load, like during push-ups or gripping. Another joint in this region is the midcarpal joint. So, if we look at the carpal bones again, remember they're arranged in two rows, a proximal row and a distal row. And the joint formed between these two rows is what we call the midcarpal joints. Now, it's not one single joint space, but a collection of articulation between the proximal and the distal carpal bones. And because of the way these bones are shaped, the midcarpal joint as a whole have a bit of an S shape when viewed from the side. It's not a huge contributor to movement on its own, but combined with the radiocarpal joint, it significantly increases the wrist's range of motion, especially in extension or wrist bending back. Functionally and anatomically, the midcarpal joint is closely related to the intercarpal joints. In fact, it is reinforced by the same sets of ligaments we just talked about, the palmar and the dorsal intercarpal ligaments. So although they are named differently, they more or less cover almost the same area. Alright, so we've now covered all the joints up until this region. The radiocarpal joints, the intercarpal joints, and the midcarpal joints. The next two are the carpometacarpal joints and the intermetacarpal joints. Now, before we jump into these, let's orientate. Here are your carpal bones, these are your metacarpal bones, and these are the phalanges, or finger bones. That way, the carpometacarpal joints, or CMC joints, are right here, between the carpal bones and the metacarpal base, hence the name. These joints are strongly supported by ligaments, named, as you would expect, the palmar and dorsal carpometacarpal ligaments. They keep the base of the hand bones securely linked to the wrist bones. But now, look at this one, the CMC joint of the thumb. Notice how different it looks? That is because it is different. This joint is a saddle joint, which gives it way more mobility than the other CMC joints. It allows not just flexion and extension, but also abduction, adduction, and that cool thumb movement called opposition, where you touch your thumb to your fingertips. That's all thanks to the CMC joint of the thumb. So that was the CMC joints. Right next to them, we've got the intermetacarpal joints. These are the joints between the base of the second to the fifth metacarpals, so between the long bones of the hand themselves. They are held together by another set of ligaments called the dorsal, palmar, and interosseous metacarpal ligaments. Alright, moving further down, we get to the metacarpophalangeal joints, or MCP joints. These are the joints between the metacarpals and the proximal phalanges, basically your knuckles. What's interesting with these is how well protected they are. They've got dorsal, palmar, and interosseous ligaments, just like the intermetacarpal joints, but also the medial and lateral collateral ligaments and the deep transverse metacarpal ligaments. These work together to stabilize the fingers during flexion, especially when gripping or pushing against something. The next joint lies between the finger bones themselves. We have the interphalangeal joints, or IP joints. In each finger, you've got the proximal interphalangeal joint, or PIP, and the distal interphalangeal joints, or DIP. Now, the thumb only has one interphalangeal joint, not two like the rest of the fingers. That is because the thumb has only two phalanges instead of three. So we just call it the interphalangeal joint of the thumb. Easy enough. Now, what's cool about these joints is how compact but stable they are. They are supported by medial and lateral collateral ligament, which keep the joints from wiggling sideways, and also by the palmar ligaments, which help resist hyperflexion. You will sometimes hear these referred to as volar plates in clinical settings. So that is it for the joints. We've gone through all the major articulations of the wrist and hand, and also the ligaments that support these joints. But you might be wondering, what about the other ligaments you're seeing here, like the palmar aponeurosis, the superficial transverse metacarpal ligament, and the palmar carpal ligaments? These structures are absolutely important, but they're not primarily responsible for stabilizing joints. Instead, they help define the shape and structure of the hand, and more importantly, they guide and protect the tendons of the muscles that move your fingers. For example, the palmar aponeurosis is a thick triangular sheath in the middle of the palm, and it functions like a stabilizing roof for the flexor tendons. The superficial transverse metacarpal ligaments sitting at the base of the palmar aponeurosis helps keep the soft tissue in place when you grip something tightly, and the palmar carpal ligaments up here is part of the flexor retinaculum complex that maintain the tendinous alignment across the wrist. So these structures are more about the soft tissue organization and tendon protection rather than joint mechanism. But if you're curious about how all of these ties together with the hand movement, I've made a full video just on the muscles of the hand. And I've also created a detailed visual PDF study note that breaks down the tendinous sheath and support ligament layer by layer if you're interested. Now, before we finish, here's one final tip. The names of the joints we've covered are directly tied to their location. Radiocarpal equals radius to carpus. Carpometacarpal equals carpus to metacarpal. Metacarpophalangeal equals metacarpals to phalanges, and so on. Once you grasp the naming logic, the anatomy gets a whole lot easier to remember. And with that, we have officially covered all the bones and joints of the upper limb. We have covered the axial and the appendicular upper skeleton. So what's next? In the next couple of videos, we are going to cover the lower limb. We will look at the bones and the ligaments of the pelvis, femur, tibia, fibula, and the foot, starting with the hip bone or pelvis. Click the next video and I'll see you there. If you want handmade PDF version of this lecture, take a quiz to test your knowledge, or access an organized list of all my videos, you'll find everything on my website. Thanks for watching, see you in the next one.